Hello YouTubers, and welcome to part 2 of the bedhead hair clipper, a look inside. Now, as you'll know if you watched part 1, and if you haven't watched part 1, I suggest you do. We opened up the clippers, we saw that the rechargeable batteries inside were shot. I went and replaced them with my own rechargeable batteries, but then discovered that the power supply for it was putting out between 8 and 11 volts when it, in theory it should be putting out 3. So it either seems like the charge is faulty or there's something wrong, because obviously that's far too much for the required 3 volts and the stated 3 volts on it. So what we want to have a look is have a look at inside that power charger today, or that power supply, and see if it's got more intelligence, whether it actually does a charge or not, and understand how it works and see if it's faulty. So let's get down to the bench. Righty ho, so here we have the power supply unit opened up, and literally in between me kind of jumping to the bench, I've been scrabbling to try and have a look at some of the components on this, in particular obviously this IC, and I managed to take a photograph and eventually work out the what it was. So let's just have a quick look at that, because this potentially now becomes a far more intelligent unit than I originally thought. So here is the data sheet, and all this information I'll post on my forum, because I think a lot of this will go beyond what I can fully explain and I can demonstrate here. Also, there are folks already posting very useful and valuable comments on part one, and I assume here under part 2, please read what people write, because they'll pick up a lot more than probably I am. But anyway, it's an IC that's made by a company called ST Microelectronics. We've obviously got the DIP 8 package here, and there's some information here in terms of some basic specifications about it, but let's just quickly read the description. The Viper 12A combines a dedicated current mode pulse width modulated controller with high voltage power MOSFET on the same silicon chip. Typical applications cover offline power supplies for battery charger adapters, standby power supplies for TV, monitors, auxiliary supplies, motor controls. The internal control circuit offers the following benefits. Large input voltage range on the VDD pin accommodates changes in auxiliary power supply. This feature is well adapted to battery charger adapter configurations. Automatic burst mode in low load condition and overvoltage protection in hiccup mode. And then it has a basic block diagram of the actual chip itself. And just at a quick look from myself, I can see, obviously it seems to have some op amps. It's got some logic gates and an oscillator, and then the FET as well. And further into the documentation, I say this is a multi-page data sheet just for that IC. It then provides a circuit diagram for a complete regulation system. So it's a circuit which can control both current and voltage. So there certainly seems to be more than meets the eye on that that IC, and obviously with all the bits and pieces around it, it could very well be configured in quite an intelligent operation. Now what I'm going to try my best to do in this exercise is connect it up to the clipper and try and monitor and see if we can, first of all, what we'll have a look and see is, there's obviously some basic stuff we can have a look at. There's a transformer which transforms the mains voltage coming in. It looks like the diodes over here are a full wave rectifier, and there seems to be a reasonable sized power resistor over here. There's obviously some capacitors here for smoothing and the operation of the actual IC itself. Obviously the LED to show it's in operation, quite a big diode over here. Another capacitor and this little blue device, I'll actually just quickly show you on camera. I had to take a picture to try and zoom in to see what it was. So here we go, on my little handheld camera, I managed to, fortunately, this little camera, I can manage to zoom in and get a quite nice macro shot.
and there is the information on that. What I thought might have been something to do with input protection, but it's by all accounts a ceramic capacitor with a fairly high voltage range. If I read correctly, it says, I think it's 1000 volt, 250 volt. So I think it provides some filtering. It's a special filtering cap. And again, I'm sure folks will be able to tell me exactly what it is on the comments. I'll post these pictures again in my forum so that folks can get a closer look at that. So those are all the bits and pieces. And then obviously here's the output to the actual clipper itself. Then on the underside of the board, again, they... And it'll be interesting to see what input folks have to say, but it seems as though there's a little more effort that's gone into the design of this board. There are these slots cut in here, which I assume this slot, I'm not too sure, but I know that this slot over here is across that big power resistor. So I'm again assuming it's to prevent any arcing or jumping across the board over there. And likewise over here, I think there's a separation between the input and output sides on this, and there are some small surface mount components. And as long as I can keep my camera in focus, there are some small surface mount components on here. Probably some, I assume, some resistors over here or diodes, probably surface mount resistors. These ones, my gut feel is they look like Zener diodes, but again, I could be wrong. And then there is a pot over here, which is obviously set to set some adjustment for that IC in terms of controlling its output or how it operates. And then here is another little surface component over here. And all of these, I say, what I've done, I've tried to take some high-res photographs of these. These are noted, in fact, they're R1, R2. So those are resistors, R3 over there. ZD, oh, so there we go, Zener diode 2, so I was probably correct, Zener diode ZD1, so these are Zener diodes. Diodes we will cover off, in particular Zener diodes as well, when I start the electronics tutorial soon. C4 over there I can see, so that's definitely a capacitor. Okay, so there's a fair bit of circuitry around this IC. What I'm going to do now is connect it up. I'm going to reconnect the battery on the clipper, and then see if we can have a look at the different output stages of this to see if we can get a basic understanding of the operation. Probably just the circuitry on this itself could do a whole look inside video itself to see its operation and how it works. But at the moment, I don't have time to go into that. We'll see what we can achieve with some basic measurements before we end off this video. Okay, so let me explain what I've set up then and what we're going to try and have a look at. I've got the power supply slash charger, if indeed it is fulfilling that function, plugged into the step-down transformer. At the moment, the step-down transformer is switched off. I've safely clipped on these little probes onto the input side so we can see the main signal coming in through there. And then we'll trace it through the after the rectification bridge and what have you. So I've got my little Unity UT81B set up here. I'll just get the camera set up and then I'll switch it on so we can have a look at the signal coming through the mains before it starts getting rectified and filtered. Okay, so at this point in time, I've got the power supply switched off. My hands are safely out of the way, so just be warned. I know people are concerned about me probing with kind of with multimeter probes the last time I did this. But my hands are totally free. Don't do this yourself because I've got live components exposed, which obviously can give you a nasty jolt if you touch them inappropriately. So we'll switch on the power supply. We'll just let the scope settle. And there we go. As you can see, the divisions, volts per division, has gone to 50 volts. I'll just bring you in a little bit closer. So we've got 50 volts per division, and you can see the frequency is at 50 hertz. So this is interesting because in theory, this should be setting up for US power. So let's just count the divisions. We've got 1, 2, just shy of 3. So the voltage RMS will be, we'll get a multimeter on this now to check that it is putting out the kind of 110, 120 volts RMS, but obviously peak to peak, we've got that higher voltage. Now, if you want to have a look at all the calculations and the figures and what have you in terms of what's going on here, have a look at my first video of a look inside on the LED light, because I go through all that and draw up the diagrams. But that is the initial signal, the AC signal, main signal coming in, and we'll have a look at it once it's rectified. So here we go. I just quickly thought I'd put the multimeter on so we could see the RMS value of the voltage. So it's coming out at about 114 volts AC. And if we look at the frequency, it is indeed 50 hertz. So this transformer is not doing anything with the frequency. It's keeping the frequency the same as our main supply here in South Africa. I suppose if it was doing the right thing, it should take it to 60, but I suppose they're not going to do that in a little cheap step-down transformer. Right, and what I thought I would just also demonstrate, although we've got the 114 roughly RMS coming in, if I push this crest button over here, we can actually see the peaks of the actual AC wave itself. So if you remember on the scope, it's going up above into positive and down below zero, and that's the one side, that's the minimum, the negative side below the line, zero line. And then the max minus the min, so the peak to peak of that AC wave coming in will be about roughly 314, 315. So if we take a look at a diagrammatic representation of what's going on, we've got the live and the neutral coming in from the step-down transformer, so that would be your AC input, and it's coming in straight into a bridge rectifier. So as I pointed out over here, that was our AC wave that we saw on the scope. It's got a peak of roughly 1 positive 157, negative 153, so a peak to peak of roughly 315 volts. But of course, that gives you an RMS value, an average value, root mean square value of around 114 volts. So this circuit is a little different from the one on the LED emergency light, because the one on the LED emergency light first went through a step-down transformer before going through the bridge rectifier. So we'll follow this through and see what happens, but now what we're going to measure, we want to put the scope on this side over here and just see what this signal looks like after the rectification. Just as a comparison, this was the circuit from the on the input side of the LED emergency light, and as you can see, it first went through a transformer which stepped it down before going through the bridge rectifier. But in this case, it seems like it might be the other way around. We first got the rectification, and I assume then it's going to go through the transformer. Right, so what I've done now, I've hooked up the two probes on, we've already measured the kind of input AC side, and now we're going to measure the output after the bridge rectifier. So I've got a probe connected over here and over here, and here down below you can see these are the bridge rectifying diodes, 3 and 1, just placed up over here. The reason this one's placed up here is presumably because they didn't have a length to put it in, and then I've got my clips set up as per that diagram on the output of the bridge rectifier to pick up the voltage coming out. So obviously what we're expecting out on the other side is a DC voltage, but still a high DC voltage because it hasn't gone through the transformer in any way. Okay, so here we go. I'm just about to switch on. It'll take the scope just time to pick up, auto sense the wave, and there we go. It's 50 volts per division, but it's straight away telling us a voltage of 154 volts. Which makes sense, because as you'll remember, the peak voltage coming out of the AC side was sitting at about 157. There'll be losses due to that bridge rectifier, so there's a slight voltage drop. So that 154 makes sense. And of course, what have we got now? A straight DC wave. It's taken that, it's rectified the wave, it's obviously pulled it up, and we've now got that straight DC voltage. Now this appears to be a very clean DC line. There's no, you can't see any AC ripple on there from the at the resolution we're in. So obviously the filter capacitors are already having their effect, and they've cleaned up, so we've got a nice clean rectified DC voltage of 154 volts. So now we'll see where that goes to. I'm assuming it goes to the step down transformer, and we'll have a closer look there. Okay, so now that we've kind of had a look at the output of the bridge rectifier, let's just have a look at what we'll scope next. So we've had the mains input coming in through here, through the bridge rectifier. I'm assuming again now there's obviously some filter capacitor filtering with the capacitors on the output, which is obviously smooth that DC, but it's a high DC voltage at 154 volts. It now goes in through the operation of this ST microelectronics IC, which I spoke about earlier, the Viper 12A. I obviously don't have a scope to easily sort out what's going on there. So again, I'll leave that for those folks who are wiser than me. And also, a good read of the data sheet should provide a fair bit of information there. What I am going to do now is obviously the output of this IC now goes through the primary winding of this transformer. So that I would presume obviously steps things down to the secondary side, ready for the output over here. And there's that filter cap over here. So what I'm going to do now is, I'm assuming and from the data sheet, I think this IC can work at quite high voltage. So that's why they haven't deemed it necessary or haven't stepped down the voltage beforehand. But now the output of that in the regulated side of it, if indeed it's regulating and doing some charge control, is going through here and out. So we'll first measure what is actually coming out to see whether it is high or low voltage going into the primary side, and then measure what's coming out the secondary. And what I've done here on a circuit diagram is just to represent that. We've obviously now got the bridge rectifier, the cleaned up DC side coming out here, the output, the DC output is obviously being filtered, and now it's going through that IC with the supporting surrounding and supporting componentry, which I've drawn here as a block. It's then going through here to the primary winding of that transformer, and then obviously out to the secondary side to the DC output. And we want to see what's happening on this side next, to see what the voltage is and what's happening prior to the output. Right, so let me show you what I'm carefully probing again. And as you can see, again, I'll just say it's my hands nowhere near this, having to hold probes. Fortunately, these little probes, I've managed to pick up 2 points. What I believe to be the inputs of the transformer are these two here. There are several pins on the input side. The pins underneath here, which if you can see carefully, there's a long line which is all soldered together. So it seems to be one side of the IC is all soldered together in one long line and comes out over here, which goes into the transformer. I managed to clip onto a pin over there, which was easiest, but still that's the common point I'm measuring. And then another point here. So we'll check that out. I might be wrong, but let's look at the scope, and that should be the input to the primary side of the transformer. Right, so I'm about to switch on. Let's hope I've got it right and nothing goes bang. Interesting. That seems to be very messy. But I wonder. So it's saying, whoops, it flicked there. The scope is probably struggling. It's saying DC 100 volts, which obviously makes sense. There's obviously a slight voltage drop, but you can see the frequency. There's a lot of noise on the signal. Now, either I've probed in the wrong place, or this has got something to do with the pulse width modulation, although I would be expecting a square wave out. So I'll have a bash at another point just to see if I've got it wrong. But anyway, let's just note this. So 100 volts going at quite a crazy frequency. That looks a bit noisy, to tell you the truth. So I'll see if I can pick up another point or whether this is actually the input to the transformer. Okay, so I've probed a few points of what I would think are the input to the primary of the transformer. Now, I either get that signal that we saw earlier, or this positive or negative kind of straight DC, rather kind of noisy looking, this band going into the transformer at 154 volts. So I was expecting perhaps something a little different, but what we're going to do, we'll just accept that for now. It's the best I can do with all the probing I've done on the input. We're now going to the output and see what the output is before we go. Obviously, it goes into the clipper itself. Right, and just to show you whether I've got the probes to look at the output, the transformer obviously sits on the underside of the board here. The primary side is the pins on here, which I was probing. And then the output, there are two wires which come off it. And the one output wire, you can actually just see through the board there, comes in through here, which I've got the probe on the other side actually hooked to the leg of a diode that it goes into. And then the other wire comes down over here, where it also starts going into capacitors and what have you. But those are seem to be the direct output of the transformer. So we'll see what voltage is coming out that end. Rightio, so ready for turn on. Right, so as you've seen from when I initially turned on, the scope is going quite haywire trying to measure what was going on. I'm playing around with these settings. At the moment, you see what I'm playing with is the volts per division. I'm just going to take that down. You can see the signal seems to be very messy coming out of that transformer. You can see the frequency that it's noting. The trigger point, let's just see if I can. So it looks like at 5 volts per division. Let's just see if we can change that. Just changing the time base now to see if I can get a wave. The trigger point is sat over there. Let's see if I can make any changes with that. If Father Christmas is listening, I need a new oscilloscope. As Unity, I must say, has been very handy for these exercises, but obviously it does have limitations. So I wonder if that's the best I'm going to get and whether that's correct, whether we've got, it looks like the kind of peak, well, the peak to peak of that, if it's, that's like 20 volts peak to peak, if that's to be believed, and going at alternating at a crazy frequency. I'm going to try pick up another point and see if I pick up a reading that seems more sensible on the output, and then we'll go directly to the output of the actual plug itself to see what that tells us. Right, I've just moved the output clips just beyond across a capacitor, which is after the output, secondary output of the transformer, and we're getting what we probably recognized from before, that just 8.4 volts as a filtered DC output, which will be exactly what's coming out of the end here. Basically, the only thing beyond where I've got the clips is a zener diode, which will obviously provide some regulation, I assume. So by the looks of things, the transformer is just stepping down from that what seems to be 154 volts. And I say the noise or what have you, I don't know again whether I'm just picking up something crazy on the scope or what's coming out. I might have been expected to see, what we're going to look at is what happens under load. So I'm going to connect this up to the actual clippers so that it's charging the battery. And I would have thought if some, seeing as they have that IC and some intelligence employed, is to perhaps see some pulse width modulation controlling the current and regulating the voltage. But let's put it under load and see what we see here. Right, so let me explain the setup then. I've got the clipper set up over here with a set of leads attached to the battery so I can measure the voltage. Now I did run the motor a little bit just to drop it down so that in essence it would start charging. I'm going to use my Fluke 287 to monitor and record the actual, to graph the voltage, so at least I don't lose that information. I'm going to try and set it so I capture, let's say, every, maybe we should make it every 20 seconds. I'll make it that it captures a data point. We'll okay that. I'm going to start that. So we've got the live reading there, the time and date. Are we correct? Yes, just about. And now I'm going to switch on and we'll see if we get anything odd over there. So we've got an output of 6.1 volts now from the actual, I've still got the clips linked to the output of the of that transformer slash charger. We can see the voltage climbing in the battery. So I will leave this to sit and take measurements, and although we're not seeing too much interesting on the actual scope itself, I can't see any pulse width modulation, but perhaps it is doing some regulation. That drop, I suppose, I would attribute to now obviously there being a load across the batteries. But let's leave this for a while. Ultimately, what we want to ensure is that the voltage doesn't go over about 2.8, 2.9 volts. The charge light, if you note there, is on. So it'll be interesting to see if it hits a point where the light goes off. There's, I say, some interesting comments there which may attribute the circuit design where that may go off once it's actually finished charging. So this will be part of the education process. So I'll leave this and we'll come back and we'll actually look at a graph and see what's happened. Okay, I thought I'd just quickly pop this piece in while I'm still charging and monitoring what's happening on the battery voltage. I have since changed the update interval to 2.5 minutes because I was going to run out of time. It was 20 seconds, but at the rate this is going up, you'll see the last digit changes fairly slowly. I mean, that's the handy thing again with the resolution. At least we can see what's happening. So that'll slowly graph. And then what I have done, because I didn't set up a means to easily measure the current, obviously measuring the current on the setup can be a little fiddly. So what I've done, I've just carefully spliced the cable, split the actual DC cable to allow me to put my little low current DC clamp on there. And then we can see at least I've got a record at the moment that it's drawing about 113, 114 milliamp. And then what we ultimately want to see is that, and that the current comes to a stop as well. So I'll let it carry on and we'll pick it up when it's done. Okay, so we're on the next day already. So we've had a whole afternoon through the night and into the next morning with the charging. We can still see that the voltage coming from the actual power supply slash charger is about 6.81 volts. The voltage across the batteries, I suppose, has settled at this 2.95. It's kind of settled around there, but you can still see, and I checked this late last night, there still seems to be a constant over 100 milliamp flowing in. And I think now that is just flowing in and kind of dissipating in heat off the actual batteries themselves. So it's at this point in time, I'd have said, if this is a proper charger, then the current should certainly have been shut off, because you don't want a constant current just endlessly flowing into the battery. So what I'm going to do at this time, we'll quickly have a look at the graphs just to show what has happened over the course of the period it's been charging. And then we'll have a look at the voltage drops across some of the resistors. This is something I picked out people mentioning in the comments from part one. So we'll just look at the voltage drops. And then what I might do, where there was that little pot or adjustment on the power supply itself. I want to see if I can adjust that to get a better voltage coming out of it, and we'll also try that under load. Okay, so what I thought I'd do is, what I can do under load obviously is switch the clippers on while I've got it all connected up, and we can see what happens. So I'll do that now. Okay, so there you go. It's now drawing just over 700 milliamp. The voltage is sitting at slightly higher now, but the voltage has dropped, note, from the power supply. Now, perhaps still that think that's still perhaps a little bit higher, so perhaps that's where the adjustment on the pot might actually help. But at least this is one test of the system under load. Right, so let's just have a quick look at what the trend, what was saved on the Fluke 287 yesterday when I started the data logging. We trend that. So if I take it by, it started off at 2.59 volts, as you'll see down there, and it gives you the time. And as you can see, it slowly started building up. So that went up to 2.79. We'll look at the next one. Starts out from that 2.79 where the previous trend left off. It's 2.9, slowly starts going 2.93. 2.94 is where that ended off. And here we go, so then the final trend again start where the other one left off, about 2.94, going up 2.94, 2.95, 6.79, and kind of staying around that mark, 2.95. So that was the kind of trend of the voltage over time where it actually charged to. Right, so just out of interest, what I thought I'd do was just look at the voltage that, which is being dropped over that that resistor, which is the 33 ohm resistor over there. Right, so now I've just taken the measurement across the diode, which is obviously 0.77, which is probably what we would expect. So with the voltage currently under charge load of 6.8 and those other voltage drops, that does, I suppose, bring it to around the roughly 3 odd volts which would be required to charge the batteries. And again, from reading the comments from part one, this all seems to be in order. The only thing that I'd query is that 100 milliamp, which is still going to the unit after all the charge time, whether it's just, I don't think that's obviously really good for the batteries. If it were a proper intelligent charger, it obviously should turn off the current after a certain time. What I am going to attempt to do, just for fun, as I said, just to try and adjust that pot to see if it does make a change here. I'm just keen to see if it changes anything else. So let's have a look at that. So there we go, I'm turning the pot, and as you can see, the voltage is going up, so that certainly adjusts the voltage. Right, what I'm going to attempt to do is, what I'm keen to see is, if I adjust the voltage down, is when I get to a point when I actually reduce or stop the current flow. So in other words, I will drop the voltage. I mean, if I can drop the voltage across the battery to more like 2.9, that might be a healthier level. Okay, so what I have gone and done, sorry, it's a bit tricky, is trying to balance arms and everything else to get the pot adjusted. But what I did go and do, you can see the output voltage now is down to the drop, while it's under charge load, is 4.16 volts. And there's only 16 milliamp flowing into it. The battery voltage is obviously slowly dropping. I presume it'll now drop to slightly below 2.9. I think anywhere between 2.8 and 2.9 will be sufficient. So I'm hoping this will give a better charge of the battery. If the voltage is reduced just that little bit, it means it's not going to be driving it right up to this level and still have 100 milliamp going through it. It's going to get to the point where it's only going to sit and trickle. And that hopefully will preserve the battery a little better. So I'm going to leave it there for now. I'm going to package it all up and see what, hopefully we can get it all together and working okay. So here we go. What I thought I'd do, just here we go. It is together now, fully operational, and most importantly, buzzing along very nicely. Hopefully with that adjustment on the kind of power supply, it's got a little better charging, so it hopefully won't overcharge in any way. Also, the batteries I've put in there have got perhaps higher capacity, so hopefully they'll work a little longer in terms of the usage I get out of this. And what I thought I would just show you, as someone did comment and say, well, were the batteries really knacked? And there we go, 1.065 across what should be reading at least 2 point something. So these are definitely had their day.
So there we go. All in all, I think a really nice exercise. I've managed to at least repair these and get them back together and make them usable again. I thank all of you for the comments you've been posting on part one, and I'm sure there'll be good pearls of wisdom here posted on part two. Hopefully, as I get to do more of these, I'll obviously extend my knowledge and be able to add a little more value each time to these little exercises, but I certainly do appreciate the input. But for now, I suppose there is one last thing to kind of end off the whole exercise to make this all worthwhile. You're not going to believe this. I started cutting and it... Only joking. And there you go, through the miracle of video, all done. No more than about 5 minutes in the shower. Quick shower off of the hair and all done and dusted. I can highly recommend it. If you're a person who loves a good shorn head of hair, it's a quick, easy way to do it without the fuss of going to a barber, paying for a barber, and inevitably they never get it all done properly. So I think a great little upgrade and a great little repair. For those who are interested in these, I will put a link down below. There is a later version of these on Amazon. So if you do want to support the show and buy a pair, then there's a link down below. But anyway, I thank you very much for watching. Please, if you gain any value, give us a thumbs up because it always helps. And I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.